From Penn State Health, this is Ask Us Anything About Stroke and Mini Strokes. I'm Scott Gilbert. While the term mini stroke may not sound serious, such an episode can be a clear warning sign that a stroke may happen in the future. As most mini strokes produce temporary symptoms, they are often ignored, and that can be dangerous. We'll learn about mini strokes as well as strokes and why all of this should have you thinking, be fast. We'll tell you what those letters mean. We'll learn more from Penn State Stroke Center program coordinators Alicia Richardson and Cesar Velasco. Thanks to both of you for being here today. Let's start by talking about mini strokes, the more clinical term, transient ischemic attacks. What are they exactly? And you know, let's compare those to full-blown strokes.
Well, Scott, like you had mentioned, they're temporary episodes of a neurological event. Someone might have some symptoms of facial droop or slurred speech or confusion, and they go away within minutes or up to a couple of hours, and may be resolved within the first 24 hours.
Yeah, so it sounds like a lot of the same symptoms as a stroke, but the difference is how long they last.
Exactly. So they are short, and like Cesar said, it's the same exact symptoms as you would have in a normal stroke, but they're very important. They're our warning sign that a stroke may be occurring later on, and it's important to manage whatever risk factors you have so that you can prevent a future stroke.
A potentially helpful warning sign. Do patients always view them that way, though?
Unfortunately, they don't. Unfortunately, we have seen patients come into our hospital hours beyond the window of time that it's actually started. And that can cause us to have concerns as to what treatment options are available to them.
So when it comes to a mini stroke, though, people may say, oh, well, this episode happened. Like you say, transient by its nature means it goes away. Why, you know, how hard is it to drive home the point that these are symptoms you still should be seen for even after they go away?
Right, because there's a high percentage of patients who actually will go on to have a stroke. It's really important, even if the symptoms disappear, that they be seen, and not by their primary care doctor or not by their an urgent care. They really need to be seen by an emergency room provider who can rapidly evaluate them for future stroke risk and modify all those risk factors.
And how likely is it that a mini stroke will lead to a stroke, either in the short or long term?
There's always that possibility. Risk factors are contributing concern. Someone who has risk factors like hypertension, uncontrolled high cholesterol, diabetes, they're probably going to be at a higher risk of having a recurrent stroke sometimes in the first 24 hours.
You're watching Ask Us Anything About Stroke and Mini Strokes from Penn State Health. We welcome your questions for Penn State Stroke Center program coordinators Alicia Richardson and Cesar Velasco. They're here to take your questions, not just mine, so be sure to add yours in the comment field below this Facebook post. Even if you're watching this video on playback, you can add your questions and we will respond as a text reply as well. So, you know, if someone were to ask you if TIAs or mini strokes are dangerous, harmless, or somewhere in between, I guess the answer is you don't really know, so that's why you get them checked out.
Exactly. So we view them as very dangerous. They're your sign that something's going to happen if you don't modify whatever risk factors you have. So like Cesar said about managing if you have high blood pressure, or high cholesterol, or diabetes, or there's many risk factors. But if you modify those, then your chances are less that you're going to have a stroke in the future. But if you don't change those things and make those lifestyle changes, then chances are higher that you'll have a future stroke.
I could see someone asking, though, because the symptoms are transient, they go away, what can you do about the situation after the fact if the symptoms aren't still there?
Well, like Alicia had mentioned, seeking medical attention promptly. Also, if you are seen at the emergency department and or evaluated at the hospital and discharged, following up with your family doctor, they're going to know that you've been admitted to the hospital and might require some changes in your medical management. If you do have high blood pressure, making sure that you're taking your medication accordingly, managing your stress levels, quitting smoking if you're a smoker, if you're diabetic, watching your sugars, and also being concerned for your numbers with your high cholesterol.
So there are a lot of ways you can actively prevent stroke then.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Lifestyle choices, it sounds like.
Right, exactly.
All right. Again, we welcome your questions for Alicia Richardson and Cesar Velasco. Just add them to the comment field below this Facebook post. And if you find this information helpful, please share this post on your Facebook page so we can help to get the word out about this important information. You know, we want to talk a little bit about the two types of stroke. There's ischemic and hemorrhagic. Those are both kind of medical words. They mean different things. Kind of break that down for us. What is, let's start with an ischemic stroke. What's that?
Sure. So an ischemic stroke is the majority of strokes that we see. About 85% of them are ischemic, and that is the blood clot forming kind. So basically, a clot is somewhere in your brain depriving that area of oxygen and nutrients. It's blocking the pipe, basically. And the hemorrhagic kind is either a ruptured vessel, a popped vessel, or bleeding into the tissue of the brain, both basically causing a lack of oxygen or nutrients to that area of the brain.
So very different things are happening inside the body, but they're both considered strokes.
That's correct.
We have a question now. Jo Lynn is asking, well, she mentioned locked-in syndrome in a comment. Wonder if you can explain what that is.
Sure. So locked-in syndrome is a type of stroke that it can occur in like your pons, which is part of your brainstem. So if you have that area of ischemic damage or hemorrhage to that specific location, it can create this locked-in syndrome. It's pretty rare. But basically, it's essentially a paralysis of your body and only the ability to blink your eyes in order to communicate with people. It's very severe type of stroke that can occur with a specific location in the brainstem.
So the brainstem stroke, how common are those? Do you see those very often?
We've had a couple of occurrences, but it's not a very common issue that arises.
And let's talk a bit about the causes of ischemic and hemorrhagic strokes. Because obviously, ischemic caused by the clot, hemorrhagic is when there is a rupture of the blood vessel. So, let's talk about the hemorrhagic stroke. Though it's a little bit less common, what can lead to that type of situation if there's not a clot involved?
So hypertension is the number one risk factor for both kinds of strokes, actually, but hemorrhages specifically. So uncontrolled high blood pressure is the number one risk factor for a bleed type of stroke.
And let's talk about that acronym. We referred to BFAST earlier. It used to be the advice was FAST, a four-letter word. Now we've added a B and an E before it. Let's run those down, and we will also add information about this in the comment field because we've got some stories at PennStateHealthNews.org that will help to explain this. But let's tell our viewers what BFAST stands for.
So B stands for balance changes, so a sudden loss of balance or inability to walk straight. E would be a sudden loss of vision or double vision. F is your facial droop. A is arm weakness. S is speech disturbance. And T is for time.
So of those, there are five symptoms, but I imagine you don't have to be experiencing all five to possibly be having a stroke.
Right, that's correct. It could be any one or a combination of multiple. Those are the most common ones, and so that's why we use that acronym to teach people so they can try to remember what those symptoms look like.
And that T stands for time. Cesar, why is that so vital that you get attention right away?
Time is of the essence. As we mentioned earlier and time again, that the sooner that you reach medical treatment, the sooner that we can help you, and there's a higher chance that we could help salvage some of that brain tissue that's being impacted by either a clot or a disruption of blood vessel bursting into the brain.
Right. And there's a certain particular type of drug referred to as the clot buster drug, but it has to be administered within a certain time frame. What is that time frame and kind of how does that work?
Sure. So it's up to 4.5 hours from when the symptoms started or when you were last seen at your normal baseline. So that's up to 4.5 hours. And then we have an additional treatment that's called a thrombectomy, where we can go in through your groin and basically up to your brain and the location of the clot and remove that clot out. And that's a procedure that can happen up to 24 hours now, but we always try to emphasize that you should not wait 24 hours until the very last, time. You should be here as soon as possible, because the sooner we get that open, the more chances for recovery.
Right. I know that some have said the phrase, time is brain, right?
That's correct. Time is brain, and we're finding also time is tissue. So the longer that this tissue is losing vital nutrients like oxygen that's traveling through the blood, the greater the brain actually ages. For every hour that goes unchanged in treatment, the brain actually ages almost up to 4 years.
It's so important to try to avoid strokes, even mini strokes, through lifestyle changes like we've talked about. Yet it's something that I think we all know somebody who's probably been affected by stroke. So that's why we welcome your questions. For Stroke Center Program Coordinators, Alicia Richardson and Cesar Velasco, they are here with us on Ask Us Anything About Strokes and Mini Strokes from Penn State Health. So add your comments, your questions in the comment field below this Facebook post for them. Any other treatments? You talked about the thrombectomy, the so-called clot-busting drug. Any other treatments that we should know about? Because and there are a lot of options out there for people, depending on the type of stroke and severity and that type of thing.
I mean, those are the two most common for the ischemic type of stroke. There are certainly treatments for hemorrhagic strokes as well. If you've got an aneurysm that caused the bleed, the subarachnoid hemorrhage is the type of bleed that would occur if you had an aneurysm, then we can do treatments like coiling that aneurysm or clipping that aneurysm. It's all kind of technical then, but there are definitely treatments outside of just the ischemic patients.
Penn State Health Milton S. Hershey Medical Center is a comprehensive stroke center. That's a designation. There are other types of stroke centers out there, for example, primary. But what does comprehensive mean compared to the other types?
It means that our hospital actually provides some advanced care treatment that's not found at the primary level. We have neurosurgical intervention capability. Not only do we provide a clot-busting agent, but as Alicia mentioned, we have the capability of retrieving the clot mechanically through the groin, as well as advanced treatment and care after post-treatment, acute post-treatment. So the management of these patients are key. We have trained medical staff and nursing that are trained in neuroscience. And so for that reason, we've received that certification from the Joint Commission.
And so, yeah, comprehensive stroke center means you're going to receive the highest level of stroke care possible, essentially.
Yeah, that's correct, that we take care of the most complex stroke patients. And not to say that primary centers can't take care of them. They just don't always have all of the resources that a comprehensive center would have.
Sure. And let's talk about who's at risk for stroke. I know, Alicia, you mentioned earlier some of the lifestyle choices people make. Age-wise, people may have the misconception that stroke only affects older people. That is increasingly not the case, though, right?
That's true. I think over the years, we've seen that statistically 65 years or older would be your age range of risk for stroke. But in the last decade, we've actually seen a 44% surge increase in the under 65 population.
Do we know why that is?
Continued issues with management of disease processes like diabetes, high blood pressure, heart disease. There's also the potential of risk factor of inactivity, being on our electronics a lot, not getting enough exercise.
So balance, eyesight, face, arm, speech. People may say, I'm experiencing a couple of those symptoms, but I'm too young to have a stroke. So it's got to be something else. I'm just dizzy.
Right, not the case. Stroke can happen to anyone at any age. It can even happen to children. So we really need to make sure that we're not being biased when we think about stroke. It can happen to 25-year-olds, 30-year-olds, 40, any age. Right. And we're seeing it happen more and more.
And we welcome your questions here for Alicia Richardson and Cesar Velasco of the Penn State Stroke Center. They're program coordinators here, and this is really important stuff. So, we welcome your questions here as we wrap up the interview here on Ask Us Anything About Stroke and Mini Strokes. So, any key takeaways, things that you just, if people could take one thing away, one thing to remember out of this interview, I think I know what you're going to say, but for Alicia, what would it be?
I think the most important thing is the time element to the BFAST, so that we shouldn't be waiting around for symptoms to go away. It's unfortunate that actually 90% of our patients don't come within the window for treatment. So meaning they show up too late and cannot get the clot busting drug, cannot get the thrombectomy, and essentially we have no time-based treatments to offer them anymore. So it's really unfortunate to see that people who have waited thinking things would go away and they didn't go away. So that's the message, is just please do not wait. Please come here quick. To an emergency department.
Because that can drastically affect the level to which you recover.
Exactly. And so we've had some stroke patients actually come after their stroke and say, I thought having a stroke would be kind of like the common cold would be, that I would get over this in a few weeks, and that the symptoms would go away and that I'd be able to talk again, or I'd be able to move one side of my body again, when in fact sometimes those deficits are with you for the rest of your life, and you're having to do lots of rehab and therapies to recover from your stroke. And so that's what we're trying to reduce, is the level of disability from stroke. So with those treatments, we can do that.
Okay. And Cesar, how about you? That one concept or one word for folks to remember?
It's an emergency situation that needs to be identified quickly and acted upon. We encourage folks in the community to call 911. Especially if you don't have a loved one able to drive you to the hospital, it's really important to call 911. The ambulance providers in this area that serve our hospital know everything about our program and the process that we use to manage these patients. And they are keen on the scene of identifying stroke patients that are properly trained and know what to do and how to transport them quickly to a hospital like ours.
All right, we have a question now from Shauna. She's asking if her grandfather, who was diagnosed previously with a TIA and was later discovered has a 60 to 70% clogged carotid artery, does this put him at risk for a stroke, and would they unblock his artery?
That's a great question. So yes, it does put him at risk for a stroke. And it depends on the degree of the stenosis. She said it's 70% blocked. So he should be followed by one of our neurosurgeons, our vascular neurosurgeon, to see whether the risk benefit of opening that vessel back up and unclogging it, essentially. A lot of times medical management, so medications can keep that vessel managed properly, but sometimes you do need a surgical procedure done.
And that starts with a consultation with a physician who can mm-hmm. help you determine the best path ahead.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. All right, great. All right, looks like we have another question coming in now. Jules asking, what kind of support do you offer patients after a stroke?
So we have a very active support group, actually, that meets at the Hershey Rehab Facility the third Wednesday. It's about 50 members large that frequently come, and it's a very fun, supportive group. And so that's the most well-known support that we offer after stroke.
I'd like to add, it's very unique. There are a lot of good stroke support groups in this area. Ours also provides an opportunity for caregivers to have an opportunity to speak to other caregivers, as well as stroke survivors, to support each other as they move through the process of rehabilitation, which is so key. Mm-hmm. Rehabilitation, the mindset, the mental health that requires to endeavor such a disability that could be impacting for life.
Right. Regaining a lot of function through that kind of practice of rehab, very important. Great. Well, we will share some information with you in the comment field below this Facebook post, including a link that tells you a little bit more about what a comprehensive stroke center is and why it's important, as the Milton S. Hershey Medical Center is just that, and also some other information on BFAST and that kind of thing. But my thanks to Penn State Stroke Center program coordinators Alicia Richardson and Cesar Velasco for their time, and my thanks to you for watching Ask Us Anything About Stroke and Mini Strokes from Penn State Health.